This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, I am sharing my screen. Guys, please confirm if you are all able to read it.
Yes, we can see.
Okay. Okay, so we will just go through the agenda slides for every session, and I'll just try to quickly explain and get revised of whatever we discuss on that particular session. Okay, so our first session was regarding performance engineering. Okay, so what is exactly performance engineering, and how, what is the difference between PE and PD? We discuss in this session. So how does performance engineering come to picture, right? So I can quickly go to the slide. So what performance engineering, how it, you know, it is a technique which involves some systematic development cycle and to make sure that all your non-functional requirements are met correctly. And you know, the performance engineering is a totally different thing than performance testing. In testing, we are just collecting metrics and reporting it, while in engineering, we are trying to improve this, right? So there are many sort of key differences between functional and non-functional requirements. So as a performance tester or performance engineer, we were only aware about the performance non-functional requirement. But there are a lot of other non-functional requirements which also relates or which can also affect the performance of applications. So like, you know, capacity, availability, reliability, recoverability, the list is on the slide. So we also discussed about all these non-functional requirements, how these requirements can affect on the application performance. Then we have seen this particular chart and in detail that what are the non-functional requirements with respect to the category. So if we are saying usability, where what is the end user level experience, what kind of documentation has to be provided to the user. Though it is not a part of your engineering scheme, but you need to be aware of it, right? The performance of your application is also depending on the most of the non-functional requirements that you don't or we don't cater at the time of requirements gathering. So we only focus on the specific non-functional requirements like response times and SLEs and all these things. But apart from that, there are some other non-functional requirements are also there, like supportability, whether the entire application once completed will support this particular hardware architecture or not, and how it is going to implementation phase, what are the challenges you may be facing in implementation. So these are again the non-functional requirements that are, you know, less valued or that are not being viewed as a non-functional requirement while doing performance engineering. So this is also a case that we need to make sure that we are actually at least revising these requirements, or we are at least having some idea about this non-functional requirement. Then we saw that how performance engineering came into picture, right? So it is a combination of your system and SPE. So SPE was earlier it was not performance engineering, earlier it was only software performance engineering. Okay, so and there was a system engineering part. So this performance engineering is combining both of the parts, and it is giving you the crux of both the things. So what was happening in software SPE is the software SPE is already only focused on the software part of the application. So how your architecture is designed and what are the types of software you will be going to choose to, you know, implement your application. And system engineering was totally, you know, it was dependent on the system requirements, the hardware requirements. So, and the performance engineering, we combine both of them and it comes out as a performance engineering, one stream. Okay, so it's an activities occurring over the entire software life cycle to ensure a solution that fulfills the non-functional requirements. Okay, then we also saw that how a system engineering fits in the performance engineering life cycle. So you can see that V life cycle, this is from the system engineering life cycle. And the left side and right side, there are some tokens you see that people, process, technology, roles, skills, and the right outside outcome is your goals, ensure that what are the inputs you're giving, what are the non-functional requirements you're giving, that are going to be filled. Then we have seen that performance engineering elements, base, and the cycle. So how it goes it goes to plan, then it goes to monitor, configure, release, it goes to peek out, verify, create, and verify, create, as you can see that agile cycle over there in verify and create. So it has continuous tests and report, and if pictures are there again, then continuous. So this agile cycles are coming over there. So at every level, we have some performance engineering, matrices of performance and tasks to do. And in the next slide, we have also seen that what are the practices and lessons of PE. So these are some common practices like risk reduction, trade-off analysis, risk-driven TDD, we call it nowadays, risk-driven design, monitoring, measurement, instrumentation. So it's a biggest risk. So performance is the single biggest risk. At the bottom, you can slide, you can see that Andre Brownlee is a very good author for this performance engineering book. So as mentioned, that most performance problems are a result of poor architectural choices. So, you know, undo, redo, or build it, then tune it. It results in consideration implementation efforts later in the software application development lifecycle. So it's better to start your performance engineering at very start of the application development lifecycle. So these are some basic practices in the performance engineering that we have discussed about risk reduction, how you can, you know, how you can plan for the activity so that you don't have any risk in upcoming future, trade-off analysis. Then we have seen that why monitoring, measurement, and instrumentation is important. Then we have seen that why we need to do performance engineering, what are the objectives. So there are different types of objectives, and it has a very good amount of benefits of doing performance engineering right from the beginning of your application development lifecycle. Then we also discuss about the performance engineering lifecycle. Okay, so this is a common diagram. It's available on Gartner. So it is the simple lifecycle at every stage. What activities are we are doing at the non-functional assessment? What are the activities being done at planning stage? What are the activities being done as a performance engineer? Okay, and performance testing. We all know what we are doing in the performance testing. Then comes the monitoring. Then performance audit and consultancy. So we have also seen that this last phase is something new, because where companies deploy, you know, individual consultants, or apart from, you know, all these phases are set up and be there, but they, if they face any production level critical issue, they can deploy any individual third party consultant, and they can have audit of their application, and depending on that, the next cycle continues. Then we have seen what are the performance engineering activities that we saw in the previous slide, and how this goes per the list testing lifecycle. So in the planning phase, you can see at the left side, the core activities of planning phase, what performance engineering activities is done in this phase, like requirement and analysis stage. This is the core activities that you're gathering functional requirements, non-functional requirements, and technology requirements. What performance engineer will do in this phase, he will overview, he will collect the performance objectives and budgeting. So budgeting is nothing but, you know, planning all your resources and how much money you plan to spend on this project, like that. So at every step of your PDLC, what performance engineering has to do, we have also seen that. Then next, coming to the glossary. So these are some basic terms that we will be using entirely through the performance engineering course, or through the, we use it day to day in our performance testing work. So performance, scalability, throughput, resource utilization, and latency. So we just understand what this, you know, basically means, that the terms we are using, are we properly understand it. So for example, if latency, we say there are three types of latency: you have server, network, and client latency. So what is server latency, then what is network latency, and what is client latency? We have discussed that in detail. So these are some other terms, then objectives, metrics, budgets, scenarios, and workload. What is the workload that we design on depending on the business scenarios and all this. We have also seen the performance streams. So what is performance streams? This you can call it as a template, or you can call it as a structure for measuring the performance of your application issues. So these are some known categories and some known issues that you can find out. So like caching, communication, concurrency, coupling, cohesion, and data access. So we also discussed that how caching can affect the performance of application. So where at which level the caching is done, that will also affect the server level caching, client level caching, whether it's application wide or it's per user caching, like that. So these are some performance frames that we discussed about that, how we can use these frames to analyze the performance of your application. Then we have seen a notional model. This it was just a model that has been come into the picture as a theoretical model, but it was never implemented. So we didn't have any much to discuss, but we just got an idea that what are the basic components that it revolves around your performance relay. So first is left side you say investigation, right side you say intervention. So at the proper point you need to intervene to investigate, and the cycle continues. Then we have seen the performance engineering framework nowadays in the organizations, how performance engineering framework is organized. So what are the levels? So we have performance testing COE, under which we have different types of tools, accelerators, people, processes, and there are different types of stacks of technologies, platforms, and there are different verticals, like we call it as a domain nowadays. So automotive domain, banking, financial domain, retail, healthcare, insurance, all these kind of domains are there. Then there comes the tools and partners which companies have partnered with, these giants like HP, Neotis for Neoload, and Dynatrace for APM and Dynamics, and this kind of tools. Then right side we have tools, right? So this is a typical performance engineering framework. We also discussed about that. Then we have seen that how agile nowadays, agile testing fits in the performance framework. So how when we are doing the performance testing, how we do it in agile manner. So we also seen that at agile, at every sprint we have given some specific requirements and how we are catering it, and at the end how we are doing the end-to-end performance testing for the entire application. Then we see that how DevOps comes in picture in the performance framework. So for DevOps, the performance engineering guy has to be involved in both of the parts, like application lifecycle as plus operation lifecycle. So DevOps is nothing but combination of your development plus operations. So development comes into picture. So whatever the activities that we as a performance engineer should think about, or we should be responsible for doing in the development phase, we have seen that. Also at the operations phase, what are the activities that we are involved in, or what kind of the tests, or what kind of the things performance engineer should do at the operations cycle, that we have also seen. Then we have seen some basic principles, design principles of how you're designing your performance engineering framework, or how do you start with your performance engineering process. So like setting the goals, then validate your architecture design early, at the as early as possible at the start of your development life cycle. And cut the deadwood means we don't have to have this high amount of memory or servers and like that. So we discussed this in detail. So you can go to the recordings or let me know if you have any questions. So tune end-to-end performance measure throughout the life cycle. So these are some few principles, basic principles that we follow for through performance engineering, that how do we practice performance engineering. Then there are some common techniques we have discussed, like brainstorming, data modeling, performance testing we already know. So triage approach. In triage approach, we know step by step for a complete, we check a complete request life cycle. Since it's originating from client till it reaches to the server and again fetches data and come back to the client. So entire life cycle of a request, that we call as a triage approach. Then static code analysis is there, so code reviews are always there. Logging and instrumentation, so what type of instrumentation you want to do when you are using any logging tool in your application. So this kind of activities are involved in performance engineering, and we have discussed the activities. Then we have also discussed what are the challenges in nowadays, right? So the applications have been coming cloud, and applications are distributed, right? So that it makes complex application architecture, and it makes hard for you to decide which part to test, which part not to test. Again, then teams are also distributed. Development teams are sitting some other part, testing teams are sitting other part, architectures are different. So it again takes time to collaborate and have a continued effort for performance testing or engineering. Same way, The technologies are evolving fast, and you know we have a lot of new mobile devices, technologies, new services, SaaS products, and different types of cloud vendors which works with different protocols and which work with different standards. So it makes a challenge for performance engineering because we have to cater all these needs. See, so this for the first session. In the next session that we had, which was about performance monitoring. So in performance monitoring, we specifically we targeted about what are the why performance monitoring we do, right? So why we understood that why performance monitoring is required, right? What is metrics monitoring analytics? So metric is nothing but the data, that raw data you get, right? And when you visualize it becomes a monitoring tool, or it becomes a information which we can consume. Right, alerting is required whenever a particular threshold isn't crossed for a particular metric. Right, so that we have seen the importance of three of them. What is metrics and why do we, you know, why do we collect the metrics? You know, to have an entire visual representation of the application footsteps over the time. Then what is monitoring? Then what type of monitoring we do? What is alerting? What are the, you know, advantages of alerting? We have also seen that. Then there we have discussed of the few KPIs. So these are some standard KPIs, not related to the specific application specific or any of these things, but these are some generic KPIs which are nowadays followed in the market. So this is AppDisk scores, or we can say user satisfaction index. Okay, so it has some calculation criteria like satisfied count plus score rating by two. So the number of requests that's meeting your SLAs, or that has been you know, under the SLA, it gets in the satisfied count. Some requests which are actually breaking the SLAs, but they are still acceptable within the toleration limit, they will be going into the toleration count and divide by the total samples you have monitored for this. So this gives you an AppDisk score. So this is industry standard nowadays. Then we also seen that response time, average response time that we usually monitor, right? So how this average response time is actually not a good idea to report or to judge the application performance. Instead, why we prefer the 90th percentile. So in the screen, you can see the graphs. The graphs are same for both of the graphs. The average response is same, but you can see the trend of first graph. When at the start, it is increasing. It goes to the peak in the middle, and then again it is decreasing. Whereas in the second graph, you can see as it already started with the high responses. Then, in the meantime, it decreased throughout the time in middle, and then again it started increasing. So these two graphs represents two different trains, but the average is same, right? So because of this, we don't. We should not actually rely completely on average response time, though average response times help us to identify at certain level of application behavior throughout the time, but we should not be completely relying on average response time. Okay, then there are two other metrics like error rates and count of application instances. We have seen that how error rates affects your application performance. And why do we need to measure it? Like, and the count of application instances. So nowadays, that no, most of the applications are in cloud with auto scaling enabled. So how this auto scaling can affect your application performance, and on how it can, you know, it may hide few of the application performance. We'll discuss this also in detail. Then there are a few other metrics like request rate, server CPU, application availability, and garbage collection. So garbage collection is favorite. Okay, then we saw the types of monitoring. So yeah.
Hey, Chaitanya, I have a question.
Hello.
Can you go back to previous slide where we talked
Yeah,
about
just a minute.
average and 90th percentile?
Just a minute. So who's speaking now? You can
This is
I
Santosh.
know your name? Yeah. Yeah, Santosh. Yeah. Okay. Okay, yeah, tell me.
Yeah. So can you just please repeat? So why average? I mean, why 90th percentile is also used along with average? What is the importance of using 90th percentile?
Yes, exactly. Have you gone to this video, Santosh, for this performance in the monitoring part, second session?
No. No.
Okay. So
what was
we
it
discussed
detailed
it,
explained
this.
there?
Yeah, I've explained it in detail that why we use. But okay, I'll just brief it out. So what happens in your average response time is right. What you do in average, you just sum with max and mean. You differentiate max and mean and just divide it by whatever the. Okay, so it's okay now, Suresh, the voice. You divide it by two or whatever the amount of samples are there. Right? So this is the average have you report. But what happens most of the times? Why we refer 90th percentile is because 90th percentile gives us a better idea. Like what is the meaning of 90th response time that we need to understand. So when we are saying that 90th percentile response time are needed to be reported, that means it gives some better understanding of your application behavior or application performance. Like for now, if I see this is my average response time graph, okay, I have one spike in between, then it goes like this. Okay, so this is my average response time graph. This is the time here, this is the units. Okay, so now you can see if I calculate the average for this, my average will be here. Okay. So I will not be able to understand this peak, whatever the peak is coming in between, that will be completely nullified when I, when I report the average response time. But when I'm saying that I want to report the 90th percentile response times, that times what I'm actually reporting is the total first 90th percentile response time is the response time which are near to the 90th percent. I mean the first 10 could. So there is a formula that we calculate for the 90th percentile. So we get 100 samples, out of which the total 90, we arrange the samples in ascending order and we get the first 90 samples and we reported the 90th sample time. Okay, so for example, if you collect the 100 samples over here for this duration, you can see that some are coming from like this is some 2 seconds, 5 seconds, and this is 10 seconds. So few cycles are 2, 5, 10, 7, 10 again, and so the 90th value is that which that we will be reporting. So why it is important is because it is more realistic to the end user perspective, right? Because when we are reporting average, we are completely eliminating the fact that some users face higher response time and some users face very low response time, or at the end, at the user end. But when we are reporting 90th percentile, we are taking that the 90th user, how much response time he faced, because at that time most of these things have been stabilized, most of the application behavior is stabilized. So when for this criteria, when I'm reporting 90th percentile, it would be near something up around here. That would be close to the sum between 5 to 10 seconds, right? So that would be my good idea if I'm taking this part in consideration. Similarly, when I'm reporting the entire when I'm reporting the 90th percentile for entire graph, I will be taking a picture of the samples at the 90th samples, taking at the closest interval for this graph. So this time, this 90th percentile will not report with this total minimum value, but some sort, it would be some samples which are close to the first 90th sample, which are close to the actual response time of the end users, which they are facing. So that is not average, right? So this is the importance of 90th percentile. Few people also report 95th and 99th percentile. So they want to also. So 99th is more close, but it is again it involves again some other facts. Like if you are reporting 99th percentile, that means it is closer to the max response time of your application, like that. Maximum response time, average response time of your graph. So that's why 90th is what industry decided to have reporting in the graph. Judge the application performance. So average is ruling out entire possibilities of these spikes or whatever the application that user end users may have behave. So if you are not given graphs, and if you are just given the matrices, like if you would have seen in this graph, if you are just given with the numbers, like the average response time was 10 seconds. But at the same time, if you check the 90th of response time, so the 90th response time will come around some 15 seconds or around some 20 seconds. So that is not the correct reporting, right? So if you are reporting average, right? So that's why the industry standard refers to the 90th response time. And there is a proper formula that how you calculate this 90th response time and why we need to do it. Okay, Santosh,
thanks,
I think
that answers my questions.
You can go back and refer to the recording again, and whatever the questions you have, you just list it out. I will try to cover it on the next session, or I can give you an over email.
Sure. Thanks, Chetan.
Okay. So we discussed in monitoring that what are the types of monitoring. So there are, as of now, in today's world, there are two different types of monitoring available, like your internal and external. So what is internal monitoring? For internal monitoring, you have an agent sitting on the server. Okay. So in external monitors, so you are just monitoring through the commands. You are just pinging the server. You are taking your monitoring, like, the sniffing tools. So these are the external monitors. So what are the external monitors we have seen, like for this Java application, .NET application, some Unix boxes? We have some commands, which we can interact with the box, and we can get some stacks out of the box. So there are some example of tools like HP Sitescope, you might have heard of, and HP BPM is there, Loadrunner is there. So these tools use as external monitors. Okay. So there is one reminder that I mentioned, that whether though these tools are external or agentless, it doesn't mean that it doesn't have an intrusive. No, it is non-intrusive. Okay, it has some overhead on the systems because you are running through the command. Then there are probes agents within servers. That is internal monitor. So you might have heard one agent of your Dynatrace, a while Introscope, Relu agent. Then there are different types of tools like Drum is there, ADRUM, and different types of tools which involves putting their agent on the server which you want to monitor, and they will report back to their cluster, and you can see that all the stats on that server and on their portal. Right, we also seen that for MS Windows system monitors. So why we specifically discussed about two operating system, because these are the only two operating system nowadays we are working. Either your server is on Windows server if you're hosting IIS, and or it would be a Unix if you're hosting WebSphere, WebLogic or Tomcat, right? So that it is also important that we discuss about the Windows system monitor. So most of the things we already know. We also discussed that how we can use the task manager to identify the slow and hogging processes. Because we generally see only task manager to identify which processes are running and which process is consuming high CPU or memory. So we also see that we can update the speed, refresh speed to normal, or we can update the speed to low, and we can identify that which process is hogging for CPU, right? We can identify that using task manager. Then we've seen some Windows basic monitoring tools like Netmon and system monitor is also there available in the Windows. For Unix system, we saw that Sitescope is available. It was a very first tool introduced by HP, agent-based monitoring tool for Unix boxes, and it become very popular. How it works, we'll discuss that also. Then we also talked about this Nikios. It's an open source monitoring tool. Then we have discussed few of the commands, Linux commands that will give you some monitoring information. So like uptime, top, and all these commands we have discussed in detail, what all these commands inform, and I also shown you on the box. Okay. Then there is some different, again, some commands are there. So what it is giving. So I have also given you one exercise for this command. So if for the new guys, if you have not received this, please let me know. I will send it across to you again. Then we have seen some other monitoring tools like VX Stack utility for HPUA, but this is rarely used nowadays. We have seen specific to the SQL Server monitoring tools, right? So it was this is a very old screenshot. So which you can see that your system, network, CPU, and everything is there, right? So this is Spotlight. Yeah, this is Quest Spotlight on SQL Server Enterprise. So for Oracle servers, you know, Oracle already have a very good tools in form of like Oracle Enterprise Manager, right? So for SQL, it is a tool like Quest Spotlight, which is similar to the Oracle OEM. You can also monitor the entire SQL server, the number of the database instances you have on your SQL servers, and you can do a lot of things. Okay, so this was the second session. Your second session we had, then we discussed about in the third session we discussed about the GC, right? So this was the most favorite topic for all, that why, what is GC, how, what are the GC KPIs that we should collect, how we are enabling GC, how the GC logs are being written, and then analysis. We have also seen the tool. So GC is nothing but when GC get triggered, just stop the whole process. So garbage collection we discussed in detail. How the process continues, right? So Java is nothing but, you know, automatic memory management, and GC is a part of your automatic memory management, right? So we discussed the structure of your GC when GC is called. So how it affects the memory area, heap area. So new objects get created in the young generation, and according to the thresholds, according to the thresholds, they get moved to the old generation, then permanent generation, like that, right? So we also seen that how heap area behaves when a GC cycle occurs, right? Before GC cycle, how it is structured, and after GC cycle, how it is structured, right? So whenever a GC cycle occurs, objects are marked which are not referenced or which are not used by the upcoming young objects. So the objects are marked that in the next G cycle that will be wiped. The used object will be moved to the server space and then port to the old generation if they survive a particular threshold. And then we discussed about the five GC types that we are having nowadays, right? So serial GC, parallel GC, parallel old, concurrent mark and sweep, and garbage one, G1 GC, right? So we have discussed in detail that how each and every GC works and what is the difference between the GCs, which GC algorithm to use then, right? So for example, serial GC, we specifically mentioned that it must not be used on an operating server because it uses the entire CPU, right? If you have a small number of CPU cores, it's okay to use a serial GC. But if you have multiple CPU cores, you should not use serial GC because it will stop entire process because it has only one thread and it is only doing one task at the time. Same way for multiple CPU cores, parallel GC was introduced. So we also call it as a throughput GC because it takes less time. You can say in the diagram there are multiple GC threads for parallel GC, right? These are the GC threads. And so these are working in parallel. In serial GC, there is only one thread. That's why it is taking so larger time than parallel GC. Then we discussed about the CMS and how the mark, sweep, and compact happens in the CMS, how it is different from the mark, sweep, compact in the other GCs. Then we also saw that how G1 GC algorithm works, and it is not as stable. So the guys at Oracle and Java, they are trying to stabilize this to make it as industry standard because it gives you the performance and throughput both of CMS and parallel GC. So it's a better algorithm for future. So we also discussed how it works. So it distributes your heap in the segments, and then it will check in a particular segment if the objects are reference or objects are not used, or they are not reference, if that those objects will be get collected. Okay, and for G1GC, we need to explicitly mention the. Okay, I hope it's better now, sir. So for G1GC, we explicitly need to mention the compaction phase, because it does not take care of compaction by default. So we need to specifically ask JVM to compact. Okay, then we have seen some basic KPIs for GC, right? So we have heard most of the time that why we monitor GC, we are checking the GC, but what exactly is important when you are saying you are monitoring GC? Okay, so these are three basic KPIs, like average GC time. So what is the amount of time your server or your CPU is spent for GC? Same way, what is the maximum time, right? So what is the maximum GC event occurred, which took a considerable amount of processing, your processing power in picture. Then we have GC time distribution. So number of GC events are there, 100 or 200 GC events, how they are distributed. So whether a GC, or in other words, we can call it a GC frequency, at what which intervals GC is occurring, right? These are some good KPIs. These are some metrics that can be used for analyzing the performance. Then we saw that how you are enabling the GC logging, right? So by default, in the applications nowadays, they already given the GC log file path, and some GC logs flags are already defined. But explicitly, we also seen that how we are going to enable the GC and how the GC log files should be given by path using two flags. So print GC details and xlog GC. In Java 9, you just have to give xlog GC. Print GC is by default is there. Okay. Then we also saw a GC log file, what type of information it has. So depending on the algorithm you are using for GC, there are really 60 plus formats for GC log. Okay, it's good to understand what type of algorithm you are using first, and then read your GC log file, because it gives different types of combinations, give you different type of information. So then we also seen that how do you monitor a GC, right? So there are two methods, like CUI and GUI. So CUI is your command user interface, using different types of commands like JSTAT, your verbose GC, JConsole, and GUI tools are JConsole, JVisual VM, right? So we also seen that how JVisual VM shows inside the Visual GC, shows you the different phases of the heap and different phases of the GC cycle. Then we also try to see that JSTAT command and what type of information they report. So like S0C, you can see on the screen. So this is nothing but your survivor's capacity, zero capacity, survivor one capacity, survivor zero used. So this is used, U is used, C is for capacity. Okay. So likewise, you get this information in the command line format. So in case if you are not allowed to run any monitoring tool on the production, or if in case you are not allowed to fetch any data in any tools, or you're not exposed to using any tools, you can use the commands directly on the servers if you have access. So these commands are read-only commands, so these are not changing anything. So you can easily access these commands on any server. So right, but it is also important that you understand what the output that command is giving, right? So we also discussed this, what it is giving. Then we discussed about JVisual VM, what is a Java Visual VM, and with Visual VM, Visual GC plugin, how it can be helpful to monitor the GC and GC lifecycle, right? So we discussed about this thresholding, right? Tendering threshold, patch tendering threshold, and the space, how it is distributed. Sorry. Okay. Then we discuss about whether GC training is actually required or not. So most of the time, in the next session, I mean, from the JVM tuning session, we discuss this in detail. So why GC tuning is required? So it is the last thing to be done, GC tuning. most of the times your problems get solved by JVM tuning only. So by meaning of JVM tuning means the heap memory options and the other options that you need to tune. So during this tuning only, most of the performance problems can get fixed. If you want to tune GC, you need to have a good amount of stats or a good amount of reports that says that GC algorithm is a problem, right? Because most of the time GC is not a problem. Problem is with the heap and the Java, other Java options that you're using for your GC. Okay, so why we do the tune to GC? In case if you find the problem with GC, why do we tune? So there are two main objectives. First is to minimize the objects which are passed to the old area. That means utilize your young generation wisely, so your survivor space wisely. The second is to decrease the full GC, because when old generation reaches to the threshold or limit, a full GC will be called. And when a full GC is happening, we all know that stop the world processes comes into picture and the application business processes will be stopped. So these are the main two objectives for your GC tuning. Then we also seen that different types of JVM options available for tuning. Like so we tune the heap area with XMS, XMX, we have new ratio, new size. So I've also given you guys an assignment on over this also, right? To try out the different options and check in your JVisual and Visual GC that how it is affecting the JVM heap sizes, right? So for GC, we have this different types of options to use particular GC. So serial GC, we have use serial GC, parallel GC, use parallel GC threads. Then CMS GC, we can use, I mean, we can enable our JVM to use CMS GC with this flags. So use conc marks with GC plus use par new GC. This kind of flags we have discussed in this session. Okay, the next session was about JVM tuning, right? So we discussed about what is JVM tuning and when it is required, what is the relation of your GC and heap, tuning GC and heap, and we saw the tools, different tools for GC and heap, right? So what is the tuning of JVM? It is nothing but it's a process of, you know, improving your JVM's efficiency by a good engineering approach determining the suitable GC and heap configuration. So what are the steps involved in your JVM tuning and when it is required, when you identify it is required to tune your JVM? Okay, so first is either if your application is already in production and you know, production application monitoring is reporting some issues, you know, overall a course of duration. So for example, after 10 days they are saying that application server is hung after every consecutive 10 days. So that means you have some problem with your JVMs, right? So some consistent behavior which is being reported by your production monitoring teams like that. So what are the factors involved in tuning? We discuss about that, like JVM vendor version. We need to use the vendors. There are different JVM vendors, right, available, and the versions we need to use specific to that. We also discussed about tuning heap and GC. So what are the parameters involved in tuning heap and GC? So choosing GC type, which GC type we should choose, right? Depending, it completely depends on what type of application you are using and what type of server is that application hosted. Then the Unix threading model. So thread safe area and different types of Unix operating system for Solaris and SUSE. There are threading model is different. So how JVM can affect, due to this threading model. So then we see the relation of GC and heap. So when a GC gets called, how heap memory area is affected. So we saw that in detail. Okay, so we also discussed about some steps involved tuning GC and heap, right? And how do we analyze or how do we monitor for a server for GC and heap? Then we discussed about heap specific to tuning, right? I think I missed one session, which was JVM architecture, right? Yeah, so this session, I'm just, Yeah, so we also had a very good session about JVM completely. So where we try to understand what is exactly JVM. We know all the things are running on JVM, all the application is running on JVM, but what it is exactly, why we are using JVM and why we need to monitor GC, HEAP and all these things, how it is constructed inside a JVM, right? We have seen that what are the types of JVM also available. So it's Java, we also discussed it's Vura, right? Once run anywhere, right? So JVM is nothing but an implementation of GRE, which provides you the platform to run your codes, right? So we also understand what is the difference between JDK and GRE. So Java is nothing but your development kit that it is, it is capable of your creating and compilation of your program. JRE, however, is it cannot use to create and compile it. It is used to run, right? It is an environment which is helping to host your program, run your bytecode, right? We have seen that difference. Then there are different types of JVM flavors, like Sun, the Sun JVM understands, right? So the Hotspot JVM and the Sun JVM, these are the two industry JVMs that are used nowadays. So you most of the time you will see only these two, Hotspot either, or you will see Sun either. So inside the Sun JVM, there are three options available, like classic, client and server. So what is classic? It disables the Hotspot JIT compiler. So we also seen that what is JIT compiler in the next slide. And in the Hotspot JVM, that is adaptive optimization. Hotspot JVM actually understand what kind of code is deployed on that JVM, and it modifies itself according to the code to give you the optimized performance, right? Then we have seen the different JVMs available in the market, right? Hotspot, and then we have Oracle Corporation, right? And then Adopt OpenJDK, Azure. So it's this I've taken this list from Wikipedia, so you can go there and find on Google also. Different types of JVMs are available in the market. Okay, but most of the time the JVM architectures are same. So there are few changes in Hotspot and Sun at the latter part, which is the last part, execution engine. But most of the architecture idea seems. So we also discussed about the entire JVM architecture, how JVM functions. So there are three basic parts of your JVM, like class, folder, subsystem, and then you have your RDE, runtime data area, and then the execution. So what is done in each and every section we discussed in detail, right? A class file is given as input to class, folder, subsystem, and it processes through this loading, linking, initialization process, and it communicates it to the RDE, runtime data area. So what happens in the runtime data area is you have the heap area, method area, and the stack area, right? So it is again subdivided in this part. So what is method area? What is heap area? We also discuss this everything in detail. Which area is thread safe? Which area is not thread safe? That also we have discussed, right? And we also discussed about the tools that we are going to use. So I think I've also shown you that this slide we haven't. So this slide we also done. I think it is not completely. I am not completely showing you this slide, but I've shown you guys a visual representation, like a visual demo. So we also discussed about this Java Visual VM tool, right? How do you use this tool? Right now, if you can see that I have one jar already running over here. So this is hello.jar. What is the different types of information you have on this tool? Like you can see in the overview, the first is your JVM hotspot, 64-bit server. So these modes I've explained, right? Client, server, and classic. So you can see this is running as a server. And you can see this the different type of arguments given, JVM arguments while running this particular jar. And in the monitor tab, you can monitor the CPU, memory, threads, and classes. So these are we also discuss about what is the specifics about heap, and what are what do you check in this meta space? What do you take in Heap? What are the states, right? And in the GGLGC tab, we also discussed about how your heap is structured. So you can see this the KPIs that we discussed for GC time. You can see there are 12 GC collection, which took 45.873 milliseconds. And it is also giving you the cost. So last cost is allocation failure, right? Thus, we also see that when a GC occurs, how this memory areas are behaving. So now you can see if this is reaching, when it's reached in this threshold, 28 MB, a GC cycle will figure, and the area from the hidden area as it will move to the S0, and whatever there is in S0, it will get moved to the S1. So like that, we have seen this in action, right? And we have also seen some other tools like GC Weaver, I think, and I show you the HP JMeter also for monitoring the GC, right? I'll just quickly show you guys a GC log file. So where this, for this particular session, I think it's generated in test GC log. Okay, so this is the GC log file that is being generated now. Okay, so you can see this GC log file, right? We also discuss about what type of information it has in it, right? Because we have given these flags, command line flags, initial heap size, max heap size, unlock commercial features. So this is for unlock commercial features, is for your JMC, right? Use large space in the. So these are the different types of information you get. So you can see this PS young generation meta space. So depending on these flags, your GC log file will look differently, right? So it at every GC I have given to print heap memory at GC. I think that flag is enabled, big, that's why we are seeing C. So there is this flag is enabled, print heap at GC. So whenever there is a GC interval is occurring, I have instructed the JVM to print whatever is the heap utilization at that particular interval. So you can see that heap before GC invocations, and you can see there is full GC zero. There is no full GC happened as of now. Yeah, so there is no full GC as of now. But all the GC that has been happened, that is due to the allocation failure. You can see this line particular GC allocation failure, and it reports you the entire heap memory. So young generation, that is the starting young generation. After the GC, it read this much bytes. This is the total size of your young generation. Same way, it reports the next cycle. So a survivor space, how much it was there, and this is the total heap size of your JVM, right? And this is the time it took for this GC. Right, and then it is again divided in your user, system, and real time. So we understood that how do you read these GC files, and how do you use the different tools. So GC Weaver, we have given a demo with this tool, right? In GC Weaver, you get this information. So this is a tool where you can which you can use to read this GC log files. So what I need to do is I just need to import the log file in this. So if I import this log file, now you can see that it is giving me a good graph. So now this log file is actually running. It is live. The jar is running in the background, and you can see this GC Weaver is giving me good amount of data. So you can to understand the legends, you can just click on this file view part, and you see all these legends. So what is yellow means your young generation. So this pink is your tenured generation, right? So this graph represents your good data. We also discussed that how you are using, how should you should use these tools, you know, to identify the GC behavior and GC pattern, whatever GC pattern your system is reporting. Okay, so this tool is also used for live GC monitoring as well as historic GC monitoring. Like if you have a GC log file and you want to understand after there is an performance issue related to GC. You can just import that file in the tool and we can analyze it. Similarly, we also seen for HP JMeter, right? Yes. So HP JMeter, we also saw that how a log file can be imported in HP JMeter and how we can access these log files. Yes, these are the free tools, Shana. You can use it. This is the file, right? Tomcat. Yeah, and just drag and drop your GC file and you get this data on your HP JMeter. So everything, it gives you the scattered plot, and one good metrics is it gives you is the stop double. It gives you in this duration, stop double. So this is the scavenging interval. So wherever a stop double process is happening. So you can also plot a line across it. You just need to check the options. You just need where it is show GC lines. So it will also give you a good graph amount. So these are the stop the world durations and the whenever it happened. So you can see for this particular DC log file that we are analyzing, these are the stop the world durations of, right? So different types of information is available that we can use for our analysis purpose, right? So these tools you can actually download from the online available. These tools are available online. So GC Weaver and HP JMeter you can download. But before that, I would urge you to go through this JVisual EM first. So understand, it also has a very good amount of information. So what is visual? In this visual GC tabs, you get most of the basic information for your GC. Right, and we also, I think we I also shown you about JMC, that how JMC works and how can you record the how you can record your application performance using, how you can monitor your application rather JVM using JMC, right? So please go through the sessions, recording sessions, and let me know if you have any other questions. So before we start, you know, the actual class where we will be trying to demonstrate one application. We will set up one application and we will load that application. We will try to generate performance issues and we'll try to solve these issues by live monitoring of this application. So right now I don't have any other VM running that I can for you. So the only JVM running is this. So this is how your JMC looks like. It gives you the dashboards and it gives you the information. Plus we have this option of flight recorder. So what is flight recorder is, it is nothing but like the same way we are recording the applications or script. It records the JVM performance or the matrices, JVM matrices. So now you can see this hotspot default recording is the infinite. So it is continuously recording it, recording the JVM performance. And you can also configure it what type of recordings you want to know, what kind of recording level of recording you want to do. So you have these templates available for flight recorders, and you can configure those templates to record the particular areas. This JMC also gives you good amount of information, like it gives you the mbeans browser, which is also available in your J console and J Visual VM. In J Visual VM, you need to install a plugin to see all these details, but in J console, it's already available. It also shows you different triggers and what which are available, then systems, then your memory footprint. So you just, if you just click refresh, here you will get the entire data, the classes which are loaded in your heap, and the good amount of information like G1 gen generation. So you can see this JVM is using G1 GC. So old generation, what is the collection? Young generation, what is the collection time? What is the duration? So whole lot of information or it's available here. So you just go through this tool, explore and try to understand what kind of information it is providing. Let me know if you do not understand any specific tab or any specific point, I will come back to you on that part. Okay, so this is what we have seen till now. Next class, we intend to generate some step-by-step performance issues, and we will whatever that we have class and see that JVM tuning, GC tuning, heap tuning. So we will do this in the live class. So we already have the sample application, I think, in one of the session. I've sent you an email for how do you configure. I think rather Kumar sent you the link, right, for that configuring that application, JPIT, I think. And we will host that application on your local system, so it's available for you to run anytime. So JPIT store is the application. Right. Let me just quickly show you this application. So it started now. So you can see in JVisual VM, this Tomcat PID. I think there is some issue with this. I need to check it. Let me just check if I'm able to access. So it started. Yeah. So this is the application that we are going to use for the demo purposes. So JPIT store, it's available online, and we also provided you the link and how to configure this your Tomcat with this application and all these things, right? So fish, and so we will be using JMeter because it's a freeware tool, and we can generate the enormous number of load on the application. So we will be using JMeter script. So if you are familiar with JMeter, you can play around the application and create your own scripts, or else I will try to create my scripts in JMeter and I can share that script with you so that you can load the application with those scripts, and we will monitor the